Now for our lecture 8, we have got formerly a professor from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, that is IIT Delhi, Professor Sunil Pandey. So Professor Sunil Pandey, sir, is a welding, fabrication and manufacturing scientist and consultant. He is currently a professor of mechanical engineering in the School of Engineering, Jawaharlal Nehru University. He's also the former vice chancellor or director of Sant Longwal Institute of Engineering and Technology, Punjab. He did his master's and PhD from IIT Delhi. He has published many papers from reputed international journals. He is well known for his contribution in the field of welding technology and manufacturing science. He has developed and established various cost-effective and national need-based technologies in the field of welding especially. He has successfully developed a teaching methodology which is based on brainstorming all the time. And he believes in only producing an educated engineer and not the paper degree holding engineers. He is responsible for developing a world-class welding research laboratory at the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. And also he produced own consumables, including underwater welding electrodes. And this is the only laboratory of its kind. And he is responsible for introducing the most flexible multi-entry, multi-exit technical education system in the country. Welcome you, sir, Professor Sunil Pandey, sir. Thank you for joining us today. Sir, over to you, sir.
So may I know your good name?
Sir, I'm Naveen Kumar.
Naveen Kumar, thank you very much.
Thanks, sir.
And I feel honored that I have the opportunity of sharing, talking to the audience from this platform. And before I start, I'd like to have some information about what is the exact number of audience right now.
I've got around 45 participants, sir.
45 participants, that's a good number. And what is their background? Are they all teachers or students or from industry as
all
well?
All are teachers, sir.
All are teachers?
Yes,
no
sir.
Student?
No student, sir.
Okay.
Some research scholars are there, sir, that's it.
So, but you are not open it to other students also?
Sir, actually, this is a faculty development program, so that's the reason, sir, it's open. So
basically, this is open for the research scholars. Some PhD research scholars are also there.
Arre, sir, kyun bureaucracy mein padhte hain? Leave and let leave concept mein B.Tech bhi kuch seekh jata tha, kya barai thi uske andar?
Sir, B.Tech wale ko AICT allow hi nahi ki thi course mein, to kya kar sakte
hain? Arre, aap chupchap bitha lijiye na AICT ko kaun sa matlab unko paisa todi le rahe hain unse aap?
हाँ सर, ये तो है जो है
तो इसलिए ब्यूरोक्रेसी छोड़ के एकेडमिक को पहुंचाता है ना, आप भी पहुंचाइए।
एक्चुअली टोटल रजिस्टर्ड पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर 115, तो सब में बिजी इन देयर क्लासेज आल्सो जो है, तो दे में ज्वाइन शॉर्टली।
चलिए, सो लेट मी स्टार्ट।
यस सर, थैंक यू।
द वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग ऑफ दिस वेबिनार इज that you have not announced the topic which I am going to cover during this presentation. So I am thankful to you for giving me fullest liberty for choosing the topic. But I was going through many times of the topic of the seminar, which is using the term micro manufacturing. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
So this is going to be, my nature is that I do not continuously speak. My lectures or my talks are interactive. So in between, feel free to ask me any question at any stage. Do not keep it pending for the end. Stop me right there and then only. And in between, I will also keep asking few queries. So there should be someone made responsible to respond to my request in between. I hope it is not too much to ask for. So now I'm sharing my screen with the audience.
It's visible, sir.
It is visible. Thank you. So the suspense on the topic is probably out, and I'll be talking about how to basically establish a research facility for additive manufacturing or 3D welding or layered manufacturing in your lab using a welding technology route. The advantage here is the welding technology gives you a route for direct metal deposition or material deposition, and you can create any size shape of the component or the product. And how it is done and what is the background of this will be discussed here. And my objective of this talk is not to complete a just a lecture of 2 hours, but I want to interact with my faculty colleagues who are in the initial stages of establishing their career. And I want them to be a real researcher or innovative researcher, such that at no stage they are labeled as follower researcher. I hope the audience will feel happy that hence onward, that their entire effort should be directed for becoming an innovative researcher rather than a follower. I hope everybody agrees with me on this. And for this, I do not want people to invest precious foreign exchange in buying the imported equipment. I strongly suggest and work on modifying the existing equipment in the various laboratories or various workshops in the country for our needs. So this lecture today will also cover the very intricate point for the deposition of material using the welding arc, and what is that intricacy in depositing the metal in 3D printing using welding technology will be discussed. And what I've seen is this particular point is, this remains untouched. So my strong feeling is, it is very important to have a strong foundation such that you can create multi-story building on this foundation. So this lecture of 2 hours attempt will be to create this foundation such that you feel attracted to, or you feel interested in taking up some activity of this kind through your BTech projects given to the students, or MTech projects, or even to the PhD students. So with this, I go to, so this is my professional introduction. It has my mobile number, my email addresses, and you should feel free to contact me anytime for any discussion, whether it's technical or industrial or academic. I feel very, very happy if somebody interacts with me on these issues. So, micro manufacturing, I'm touching, but to me, it has two definitions. One, micro manufacturing doesn't mean making tiny or micro scale components alone. There is another definition which says micro manufacturing is a manufacturing of products in small quantities using small manufacturing facilities. So my today's lecture is based on the second definition of micro manufacturing, and I will not be repeatedly repeating this word hence onward, but the complete domain of my lecture is contained within the second definition of micro manufacturing. That is, products in small quantities using small manufacturing facilities. The most promising for metal deposition 3D printing is the welding route. Powder sintering, etc., they give you limited size components. Their cost is also high. So the real practical 3D printing or layered manufacturing technology for metal deposition is through a welding route. And you may be wondering that people feel happy by using the jargons of 3D printing, layered manufacturing, additive manufacturing, etc., etc. But if you look at the welding technology, this layered manufacturing technique through welding was patented in 1920. This will be a total surprise to all of you that welding is already used in 3D printing, or 3D printing was already in use when the people came out with the idea of 3D printing, or 3D printing as an independent subject. This is already a composite part of welding technology, and we have been making 3D printed objects or layered manufactured objects through welding, and this area, a particular division of welding, is referred to as shape welding or form welding. Form welding means whatever shape or form to a finished component you want to give, you can direct your metal deposit along that route layer by layer, and finally you will end up getting a component of your, say, desired, say, design. And the issue here for you as an engineer, because technician can also do the same job, you can also do the same job, but the difference here is you will look into the other aspects of 3D printed component in weld through welding, and that is related to its dimensional accuracy, surface finish, the rate of production, the cost per unit which you are producing, etc., etc., and also how much resource saving it is resulting in. So these are the activities we are researchers or the faculty members or the academic people have to work upon hard or very hard, or if they are already in, they just have to continue working. So one process which is used too much with the name WAM, WAM, wire arc additive manufacturing. I had questioned this use of this name for this technology on LinkedIn. I had some interaction, or some people responded to what I had very strongly objected the use of this name. And fortunately, I feel very happy in telling you that this name has been changed now to Directed Energy Deposition Arc. This looks more convincing. Directed energy deposition arc means basically it is a welding arc which is directed according to the route or the shape you are producing by controlling the metal transfer from electrode tip to the object where deposition is made. And this deposition or the transfer of metal in the form of droplets or in the form of some volume of metal melted and integrated with the molten weld pool, depending upon the technology of transfer you are selecting. So today's lecture is based on deciding the technology of metal transfer or transfer of droplet from the arc to the place where you are depositing the metal for creating a 3D printed object through welding. Is it all clear, or you want me to explain anything further? Sir,
it is clear,
I request, sir. It is clear, no confusion?
No confusion, sir.
Next slide, sir.
So VAM is now referred to as directed energy deposition arc process, and it is basically, in real sense, is MIG welding or GMA welding process, and multi-pass welding in fact is an example of additive manufacturing. However, the advent of high quality computer aided design and manufacturing software has made additive manufacturing in general possible, with VAM in particular being an area of significant development. The VAM is nothing, it was already existing. All arc welding processes where we are depositing metal or doing surfacing operation is already taking care of this particular name, which is given by a particular company of welding equipment manufacturer. So as an engineer, as an academic person, we should not restrict the technology by this name. So use technically correct name as DED arc. However, almost three axis manipulator or robo arm and arc welding power source can be combined to make an entry level DED arc system. So this means if you are having any arc welding equipment, even if it is shielded metal welding process, or which is also known as a covered electrode welding or stick welding, in most of the places, very interesting outcome of vivas and say discussion with the student is, when you ask them the process which they initiated with their welding practice, they said the process they used was arc welding or electric arc welding. When you ask the name of the process, very few students are able to name the process. So various names of the process are already known to you: manual metal arc welding, shielded metal arc welding, stick welding, covered electrode welding. They are the names given to the same process of initial, where you use a covered electrode for striking arc and supplying the filler material. And when using even that process, which is easily available in all the workshops of all engineering colleges, you do not have to feel frustrated or dejected that you do not have MIG welding process equipment or TIG welding process equipment in your workshop. But I am sure that all engineering colleges at least have the power source for shielded metal welding process. Am I right? Please, sir, respond immediately.
Yes, sir.
This power source at least is available in all the colleges. So the suggestion here is that all those who are interested in doing 3D printing or making an object, layered manufactured object through welding, they should feel that they are complete engineers and they are very versatile engineers. They can manipulate and they can make things as desired. So if nothing is available except that the shielded metal welding power source, using that also you can create 3D welded objects And for this, the first initial idea you can get by doing welding in a manual mode, because I don't think that every workshop or laboratory has the welding robo or the 3D manipulator. So do not feel dejected. With time, things will be added. But initial stages, you should know how to play with the technology. Technology must be tamed. Technology should not tame you. You should tame the technology. And for this reason, you can visualize a mala. You have a one sheet, let us say mild steel sheet or plate, whatever you have. And let us say you want to make a hollow cylinder or a hollow prism, square prism, or whatever shape, octagon, pentagon, hexagon, whatever shape of to that cylinder you want to give, or you want a pipe with lot of, say, bends in between, you can start when you draw a circle on the sheet, and using your welding skill or asking some skilled operator to weld along that circle, one layer will be deposited on surface. Then ask him to build another and ask him to continue till you are able to get a height, desired height. And you can just hexo it off or cut it off from the sheet. You can start with a very thin sheet, which is no difficulty in removing or separating from the deposited 3D structure now, which is done manually. And the things of interest at this stage after making this kind of object is the type of surface finish, the downward flow of metal at the end, because you know when you are welding, reach the end of the weld bead, the maximum heat is at that point because there is no further metal on which you will continue. So the amount of molten metal is more. Metal becomes more fluid at this end of the metal or bead, and it has tendency to flow down because of the gravity and its own mass. So your input at this stage as a scientist is to minimize the effect of flowing out of metal at the end of bead or metal deposit which you are making. So this will improve the surface quality and the thickness of the layer combined with the size of the molten droplet which you have selected for depositing metal will also decide the dimensional accuracy and the concept which you can say you are trying to achieve something which is referred to as near net shape manufacturing. So welding is capable of giving you the 3D metal printed object where further surface finishing is not required for general purpose application, or you can say that further finishing or metal removal is not required, and the component which you have produced can be used for industrial application. So I'll suggest that all those who are enthusiastic about 3D printing through the layered manufacturing using welding technology, it is the cheapest way they can think of making a 3D object. You can offer this as your BTech project. You can, if you feel interested, you can discuss the issue with me. I'll try and create an object, this thing, project problem for you people. And this, I am sure that it will enthuse you so much that you will try to create more complex shapes. And more complex shape means you will try to integrate now some computer programming or CAD integration such that your welding torch starts following the desired path, such that more complicated shapes can be produced. Any question till this stage?
No, sir.
So with a resolution of approximately 1 millimeter, now you see that the surface finish or resolution of metal deposit through arc welding has reached the stage where it is within 1 millimeter, and deposition rate between 1 to 10 kilogram per hour or more depending on the arc source. If you have a bigger power source which can deliver welding current of around 400, 500, 600, 800 ampere, means so much more heat is available, and this heat means you can melt more amount of wire per unit time. You can say this more wire melting per unit time means you will increase the metal deposition rate on per hour basis, or you can create very large or big objects through this layered manufacturing using welding technology. So there is no restriction of the width which you can achieve through welding metal deposition. There is no limitation on what height can be achieved. The only limitation is on your thinking and how much you can expand. Welding gives you unlimited scope of creating any shape or any size of the object which you can think of. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So this, I think this kind of diagrams you must have seen in your BTech education or during your teaching time when you are discussing welding technology with the students. So when you see this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, up to 11, these are the weld beads which have been deposited to fill up this groove. So this is a very easy and simple example of layered deposition or additive manufacturing or 3D printing. I hope we are able to correlate the terms with this diagram. Any doubt?
No, sir.
So it means you are convinced that welding technology was already producing 3D printed parts, but with the advent of the modern scientists or engineers, they're starting or using jargons like, you know, additive manufacturing, etc., etc. But we were already doing silently. So multi-pass welds can be produced continuously or in discrete passes. The root pass can be completed with or without filler additions. Pulse characteristics of the arc can be changed to accommodate individual pass requirements. That is, I'll try and show you if possible. Just see that bead number one is quite small compared to when you see with bead number three. So depending on the requirement, you can change the volume of metal deposited per unit per pass. You can increase it, decrease it, or you can keep it constant. So this provides you all the facility. And the root run, I hope you, most of you know what is root run, but the first bead which is made is referred to as root run. And in almost all welding activities, the real challenge to welding engineer is creating a root run which is defect free. And major same type of defects which you are likely to get in the root run is lack of penetration, lack of fusion, porosity, and inclusions. Are you aware of these defects?
Yes, sir.
So in this 3D printing, when you're creating a root run of the first pass which you're making, you are trying to deposit it on a surface which is not the integral part of this metal, that is, of which electrode is made or the wire is made. And then when you are doing it on the external surface, there may be some dirt, there may be some grease, or some oil vapor, etc. on the surface, or there may be some dust particles. So when you deposit the first layer, these things, they interact with the molten metal, that vapor, oil vapor, water vapor, dust particle, they all create different kinds of defects. And the improper selection of welding parameters like welding current and welding speed and arc voltage, they create defects which are referred to as, generally referred to as a lack of fusion and lack of penetration. So the last point suggests that some cases techniques have been developed that allow lack of fusion in the root run by correcting it in the second pass. So you can manipulate or select the welding conditions in such a way that in case of any defect in the root pass, that can be corrected automatically while taking the second pass. So the challenge to a welding engineer is not the how will you deposit the layers. The challenge is how will you select the welding parameters such that these actions can be created within your process. So, dead arc uses an electric arc as a heat source to melt wire, which is then deposited as beads. The beads stick together and create a layer of metal. As with other 3D printing techniques, this basic process is repeated layer by layer until the part is completed. The weld bead is deposited as a single layer of a material. Successive weld beads are layered to form three-dimensional shapes. The arc is then extinguished and drawn to deposit a successive layer. Because dead arc uses a layering approach, material is deposited only where it is needed, resulting in less wasted material. That is, you can only allow the deposition of material where it is required. While in machining or metal casting or metal forming, you do a overall dimension and then you have to finish to a required dimension using some machining operation. But here in welding, you need not deposit a metal where you do not need. So this is one of the biggest advantage of using welding technology for layered manufacturing. Welding wire is also less expensive than materials used in powder-based additive manufacturing. This is due in part to the fact that dead arc hardware usually includes readily available welding equipment, which typically is less costly than metal 3D printers. So please keep in mind that if you feel that you want to do research in 3D printing using welding technology, and why I'm saying welding technology, because this is the easiest route you can follow. You may not be convinced initially or right now, but this is the easiest way that you can get into the research area of 3D printing. And straight away, you are entering into an area which is more desirable, which is sought after by the industry, because you can produce material object straight away. you are not producing objects using plastic or some polymers, but you are using a metallic object straight away, which can be used industrially. And you do not have to end up buying expensive. Just a moment. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir, do not feel that you do not have the 3D printer, so you're going to do 3D printing. Let people cry or hypothetical or say virtual engineers, let them cry that they cannot do 3D printing because they do not have 3D printers. But all practical engineers interested in 3D metal deposition through welding can achieve it by using the most ordinary arc welding power source in their workshop. And I'll be very happy that some of you will decide to offer BTech projects based on 3D printing of metal using your existing arc welding power source. If it is gas metal arc, it is fine. TIG welding is fine. If it is simply shielded metal welding, which is most primitive type of welding power source, but it is still excellent for your 3D metal printing. I think it is very interesting. You can visualize the shapes, try and achieve it, and see that what you achieved, test it for its integrity, and it will, I think, give you a lot of enthusiasm in working further. The dead arc is also well suited for the kinds of large metal components common in aerospace, marine, automotive, and architectural applications. Dead arc may be a good option for repairing and maintaining components like turbine blades, molds, and dies. Used this way, the worn out or damaged parts can be repaired by depositing new material on its surface. Just a moment. Please read in between. I'll get back in 1 minute. Yeah. Acha. Sirchi mein lecture mein hum aage baad mein baat karte hain, theek hai? Okay. Sorry, there was a very urgent call which I had to make. Thank you for giving me that freedom. Heat management is one challenge associated with dead arc or WAM process. This I have already discussed with you. That is to control the metal flow or to decide the surface finish of the metal deposited. You have to control this heat management is very important while depositing the metal. That is because the printing process involves high temperatures. This causes a buildup of residual heat, a problem common with metal 3D printing. The residual heat results in continuously changing thermal field. This must be accounted for if a deposited layer is to be accurate and free of defects. Any question in this?
No, sir.
Thank you. When using certain materials, shielding is necessary to create an inert atmosphere to optimize layer building conditions. This requirement means that the dead arc process must take place in an inert gas atmosphere oblique chamber. So there are materials which are highly reactive to atmospheric oxygen. Such materials definitely need the welding or melting taking place in the inert atmosphere. This can be achieved through the feeding of gas. This can be achieved through by creating additional purging of the shielding gas. Or if nothing works, then you might have to develop a chamber which can move along with the, say, torch or the electrode, such that a small area or the volume is kept under the inert atmosphere, or the whole object, if it is not very big, can be put in a chamber, but the chamber has to be charged with the inert gas, which will cost you quite a bit. So it is better to design a moving chamber in such a way that some small amount of purging gas can ensure a inert atmosphere during the metal deposition. This can limit the size of parts that can be built and increase equipment cost. So this can be taken care of by having a small moving chamber. That is not written here, but you can think of creating a chamber which can move along with the welding torch and through which you can do the purging operation. This can limit the size. In general, if a material can be used as a welding wire, it also can be used to manufacture parts by dead arc. It's very simple. Any material which can be used for creating a welding wire or filler wire means you can create a 3D printed part using that same material. Because filler metal and the base metal, they are always compatible. So deposited materials include carbon and low alloy steels, stainless steel, nickel-based alloys, titanium alloys, and aluminium alloys. For many of the materials, the deposit properties are like those expected from conventional weld metal in a joint. So this makes it very clear that to be a good 3D printer using the welding technology, you have to learn the art of or intricacies of welding technology. Without having control on the process parameters, we decide the size and heat input and the type of grain which you are getting, you will not be able to produce the 3D printed part with the desired mechanical properties. Any doubt? Any question?
No, sir.
Most wire feeds available for GMAW or GTAW processes can be used in dead arc. In general, the same limitations apply regarding shielding requirements, precision and weld position. So these are talking about the welding parameters and all those precautions which we take or implement while using gas motor welding process or gas tungsten arc welding process. Titanium alloys are usually deposited with more stable TIG or plasma transferred arc. Are you aware of these two processes, plasma arc welding and plasma transferred arc welding?
Yes, sir.
Great. What's your good name?
Sir Shivali Singla, sir.
Where are you from?
Sir, I am the student of from Slight Longowal, sir. Specialization in welding technology, BTEC, and MTEC is also in production, sir.
So you are still a student or you are teaching?
Sir, I am now teaching, sir, assistant professor, working in Lehra Gaga College, sir, Baba Hira Singh Bhattal.
So you belong to Punjab?
Yes, sir, yes.
Which district?
Sangrur, sir, district Sangrur, sir.
So you are in Sangrur, so Lehra Gaga is not far away from there?
Yes, sir. Only 45 kilometers, sir.
So that is why you are responding for every question I am putting.
Yes, sir. I am a great fan of you, sir. When you are in Slight Longowal, I also learn your lecture, sir.
Oh, great.
Yes, sir.
So this is for the audience that when I was vice chancellor, the Shivali or Shivani?
Shivali, sir. Shivali, sir.
She is saying, I used to take a subject. I used to teach along with my office requirement. But since teaching and research is my passion, I was guiding PhD students in SLIGHT. I was taking regular MTech subjects. MTech subjects.
Yes, sir. I know, sir.
One very soothing effect used to be a class of 20, officially used to be class of 140, 150 students.
Yes, sir, I know, sir.
So, okay. So, what I request other participants also to respond, because Shivali is basically trained in welding technology in SLIGHT, so she is responding to all my queries. So, this is not justice to the other participants. So, Professor Pandey, please ask other participants to respond. Shivali, you can continue to respond.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Give opportunity to other participants also.
Okay, sir. Okay. Okay.
Then do not stop responding. Continue to respond. So,
yeah.
Can I expect other participants to respond?
Yes, sir.
So please do so, sir.
Okay, sir.
Then the emerging range of low heat input MIG/MAC systems are proving particularly suitable for VAM or dead arc. So today, with the development of electronics and control system and feedback systems in the welding power source, and also in introduction of inverter technology, it is now possible to achieve majority of the desired characteristics of the welding system through a power source control. So these days, new type of welding power sources are manufactured, keeping in mind that they will also be used for 3D printing of metallic objects. But these power sources are sold at a very high price. So my sincere suggestion to all the welding engineers or say faculty members is, buy technically correct equipment without involving the name of additive manufacturing or 3D printing. the moment you start talking about 3D printing or additive manufacturing, the cost from 50,000 to 1 lakh rupees goes to 12 to 15 lakhs straight away. So please do not puncture the economy of this country. Do not allow the outflow of precious foreign exchange. You just start demanding the equipment based on your technical parameters. Do not ever tell your supplier that you are looking for 3D printing or additive manufacturing, or do not ever ask the manufacturer that can this be used for 3D printing. It means you are proving your weakness in technology and telling that salesman that you know nothing about welding technology or 3D printing. Would you like welding salesman to carry this impression of yours? I'm sure your answer will be no.
No, sir. No, sir.
So hence onward, do not ask any salesperson whether the equipment can be used for 3D printing or not. I hope I have made myself very clear.
Yes, sir.
And if you all agree with this, you will be contributing saving of multi-million dollars for the country. So start using your technical knowledge to increase the prosperity of the nation and prosperity of the people. The basic additive manufacturing system consists of a combination of a motion system to deposit material layer by layer, a heat source and feedback stock. So this motion system all depends upon your buying power. This need not be a robotic arm. This can be a simple NC machine or machining center. The programming of that center can be used for getting a desired output from your welding station. You can say use any NC programmer machine for 3D printing, or if you really want to make a huge object, then you need a robo system or robotic arm which moves on a track to cover the entire length and breadth of the area which you are developing with the help of 3D printing. So as I've already told you that even if you do not have the robotic arm or any NC system, you can simply do it manually to start with. Do not wait. I hope Shivali will definitely try it now.
Yes, sir. I will definitely give projects to BTech students, sir.
You must, and in case of any difficulty, feel free to contact me.
Okay, sir. Okay, definitely, sir.
So, WAM hardware currently relies on standard off-the-shelf welding equipment. Welding power source, torches, and wire fitting systems are typical. So if you buy anything in the name of WAM or Dead Arc, the combination of robotic arm and the power source will cost you somewhere around 30 lakhs plus. But that is a equipment for the industry, not for the research institutes or not for the researchers. If you want to be a researcher or want to create a 3D printing object, your research will convert or help in converting the existing equipment for achieving 3D printing. And that will be your PhD, that will be your M.Tech project, that will be your B.Tech project. So start converting your conventional arc welding systems lying in your shops or the welding labs into a 3D printer. Are you convinced or not?
Convinced, sir.
Audience? Other audience? Nobody responding.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, why is so much time lag? Sir, are you the only one? Because after Shivali, this is the second voice which I am listening. Nobody else is responding. I request the organizers to communicate with the audience or the delegates to respond aggressively.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. I was also there. Actually, signal problem was there, so I couldn't respond.
Okay.
Sir, I have already sent this message to all participants.
Because interaction and response from the audience make the lecture always more interesting.
Yes, sir.
Communication is two-way process, sir.
Yes, sir. Do not create a one-way traffic jam.
Yes, sir.
Sir, we will see to it, sir, and we will continue, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
The adoption of VAM is being driven by the need for increased manufacturing efficiency, its ability to produce very near net shape for preforms without the need for complex tooling, molds or dies can result in cost and lead time reductions. Increased material efficiency, improved component performance, and reduction of inventory and logistic cost. This is what I define in the second definition of micro manufacturing. With this kind of, say, concept in mind, you can do a 3D printing of metallic parts depending upon size of the room, not the closed room. Make sure that you never ever weld in the closed room. Before you start welding in any shop or any room, make sure that you have enough ventilation available. Otherwise, you are
fumes.
Out.
Yes.
Why? Probably Shivali can respond.
Sir, fumes are the gases will produce while we are doing, sir, welding.
Okay, what else? Very simple thing is you need oxygen for your survival.
Yes, sir.
How much oxygen is required for your survival?
Sir, 100% hi chahiye wo to.
100% but that 100% is around 22% in the air which you breathe.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in that 20% oxygen which you are breathing, how much is the lower level of oxygen which you can go in a human being? See, why I'm asking is these days because of corona effect, you must be talking too much about oxygen concentrators and oxygen supply.
Saturations. So 80%, 90%, sir. 90% we are before.
So being an engineer, at least being an engineer, you should know that what should be the percentage of oxygen where you are safe. In the air, it is, let us say, it is around 22%. So you should know that the problem, there are two problems. One is lack of oxygen causing you to faint or lose your life. And other is oxygen toxicity also. Oxygen either way is very, very harmful for the human beings. But right within the very small, like, you know, spray transfer mode where the current is stable. So if your variation is between 21%, 22%, you are safe. Beyond that or less than that, you are in trouble. So when you are doing it in a closed room, when you strike arc, there is always some amount of oxidation of matter that takes place when it comes in contact with the atmospheric oxygen. So this oxidation process will create a lean oxygen atmosphere in the room, and very soon it will be depleted of, you will be depleted of oxygen in the room, and you can't survive. Will faint and die ultimately. So whenever you have to do welding, first thing is check whether enough ventilation is available. If there is no ventilation, there are no ventilators or windows which can be opened. Even if somebody pays you 1 lakh rupees, say thank you very much. मैं लंगर खा के जिंदा रह लूंगी या रह लूंगा, पर मुझे 1 लाख रुपया नहीं चाहिए. आई कैन एंजॉय मनी ओनली व्हेन आई एम अलाइव. सो दिस इज ए वर्ड ऑफ कॉशन. वेल्डिंग स्टूडेंट ऑलवेज इन ए वेंटिलेटेड रूम. बट इन द नेम ऑफ माइक्रो मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, स्मॉल प्रोडक्शन विद ए स्मॉल इन्वेंट्री, if you have a small inverter power source, you can do your industrial manufacturing from your bedroom also. That is the beauty of micro manufacturing. So if you want to be entrepreneur, you can think of some component which you prepare from such electrical, say, welding power sources. You can do it in a balcony, you can do it in a, say, some storehouse or say backyard, and start selling in the market. If you are very, very enthusiastic about making a second source of income. As a generalization, if a material is available as a welding wire, so this is already covered. Dead R can be used to deposit materials including carbon, and I think this is getting repeated. I will skip this. So this is what I have to say for initiating you people in direct energy deposition arc. And this much discussion has definitely given you idea that how to use your existing power source, even if it is the most ordinary welding power source, for 3D printing. If you have any doubt, please ask me, because I am going to the next topic now. Any question, any doubt, any clarification? Or how many of you feel getting enthusiastic in creating a small industrial activity, a product, and selling in the market?
Yes, sir, they are interested.
You can come home from your lab, keep a small equipment, start producing parts, and start supplying at a small scale, giving you secondary source of income based on your technical knowledge which you have acquired. But mind it, only those engineers can do who are qualified, but those who are only the paper holding engineers will not be able to do anything. So reconvert yourself into a qualified engineer. So if you have no questions, then I am switching over to the next topic.
Sir, please continue to next topic, sir.
I am doing that now. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes, sir.
It is written various modes of metal transfer. And what you see in this diagram is, this orange color is a metal droplet which has got detached from this wire, and this what you see in the white is the arc plasma, and this is the bell shaped arc which is well protected by the shielding gas coming from the nozzle or coming due to the burning of the flux. But this is not a flux covered process, this is a gas shielded process. And this is what the welding parameters will decide, the type of metal transfer and the size of the droplet transfer and the frequency of droplet transfer, such that you can create a 3D object of desired dimensional accuracy and size and surface finish. metal transfer refers to how the molten filler metal is deposited on the base metal substrate to form the weld bead. This is what is the first step in 3D printing. You have to deposit a first layer of metal and then build up subsequent layers. So metal transfer is how the molten... Hello? Is there any question? So, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So, how the molten filler metal is deposited? So, not only the deposited, how it travels to the workpiece or the substrate will be discussed here, such that you have a required control on that quality of deposit. And before we go further, I would like to discuss the fundamentals of weld bead. When we say we are depositing a bead, means what? That means you are melting a metal from the electrode using the welding arc, and the heat of the arc is used for causing a localized melting of the base material, and the metal which is getting melted, the tip of the electrode is getting mixed up with the molten metal of the base metal. And then the after solidification, when you do the section, you see a system like this, which is referred to as weld bead. On top of this, you have, if it is a slag, you use a chipping hammer and remove it, you will see the crown of the weld bead. And but the bead which is within the weld metal, within the base metal, cannot be seen by you until you do the sectioning of the job, do the bit of polishing and some light etching, you'll be able to see this weld bead. So various terms which we use for describing the weld bead or for describing the type of metal deposition in 3D printing is all defined and discussed here. Please very quickly go through the various terms and symbols which we use. This is not the capital W, this is a small W. Please correct it. I don't know what, no, I, in this mode, I cannot correct it. So these are the bead geometry terms which are used for describing the quality of bead deposition and shape of the bead. Then there are these three shape relationships which are defined as WPSF, weld penetration shape factor, weld reinforcement form factor. AR is the area of reinforcement, as shown here, that is from this line on the surface of the plate and covered by this crown. So whatever the area you have here is referred to as area of reinforcement, and whatever area of the bead you have below the surface of the plate is referred to as the area of penetration. And using these two terms, area of reinforcement and area of penetration, we calculate one of the most important parameters in defining the weld metal quality and metallurgy, and that is the percentage dilution. And this percentage dilution is calculated as the area of penetration divided by the total bead area. And total bead area is the sum of AR and AP. And what is dilution? Any idea? Anybody who can explain me what is dilution? See, you can pick up lecture only when you keep understanding the terms which I am using. So who can brief me about dilution? No, audio is not clear.
How much amount of materials?
Okay, please continue. Anybody else?
Sir, dilution is how much amount of material is involved in the substrate material?
Which material? Filler material?
Yes, sir. That is a base material, substrate material.
No, it is the mixing of filler metal with the base material.
Yes, sir. If you use a mild steel as a base material and a stainless steel as a filler material, if you want to deposit the stainless steel material in the mild steel, there is a combination of how much stainless steel is influenced in the mild steel material. That is a dilution.
You are taking very extreme kind of say example. Because you have to go into the nitty-gritty of depositing mild stainless steel on mild steel.
Okay, sir.
Which type of mild stainless steel you are talking about here?
So we can generally talk about 304 or 316L, sir.
Okay, 316L is ruled out because L means extra low carbon stainless steel.
Yes, sir.
And that extra low carbon is what? How much?
That is 18% is nickel and
That
is 18% is chromium.
What is the meaning of L in this 316L? L refers to extra low carbon.
Yes, sir.
So in this case, your carbon percentage, aluminum percent has to be less than what?
Carbon is less percentage.
How much?
Carbon is around 0.04%, sir.
Definitely prefer less than that.
Okay,
so when
sir,
when you do a welding of mild stainless steel 316L2 mild steel, let us say having a carbon percentage around 0.15, so 0.15. when the two materials mix up in the weld pool, what will happen to the L property of the stainless steel? You will lose that.
Okay, sir. Okay.
The carbon percentage there will go beyond 0.04, because we want even 0.02 or less than that in L producing condition.
Yes, sir.
So, but dilution is basically the mixing of filler material with the base material, and this decides the metallurgical behavior of the weld metal. And mixing, because filler material is always more expensive than the base material, the dilution should be kept to only that much amount which is just required.
Beyond that,
you will be wasting or say incurring more cost while welding.
Okay, sir.
So, and another very important term which will be kept in mind or should be kept in mind while preparing for 3D printing is linear heat input, which is shown here as HI equal to this heat transfer efficiency into V into I divided by S cos phi. where cos phi is the power factor for the power source. And have you seen this kind of relationship in your BTech studies or by teaching in the classroom?
Sir, actually, we see that heat input, they having a formula. Heat input is equal to 0.6 into, that is an efficiency into they are using a current, sir.
Current and what another else?
That is another formula, sir. Heat input factor, they having another formula.
But what I've written here is I've explained the terms used in this calculation of a linear heat input.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So V is what?
So V volts, sir.
No, I'm not asking the units. I'm asking which voltage is this?
Voltage is around
open circuit.
Sir. What is your good name, sir?
Dr. Suresh.
Yes. Please listen to my question. I'm not asking you the value of voltage. I'm asking what kind of voltage is this? Because in arc welding, you come across three type of voltages while doing welding. One is referred to as open circuit voltage. Other is referred to as arc voltage, as written here in this transparency. And the third type is referred to as operating voltage. So is there anybody who is aware or who knows about the open circuit voltage, operating voltage and arc voltage? First thing is decide within yourself that you come what may, you would like to build a 3D printer through metal deposition using welding technology. At least some of you will be able to decide that. Okay. So if all those who have decided to become a 3D printer using a metal deposition, they should be at least knowing the difference between three voltages which you come across while welding. And I'm sure that you're not ever thought of this kind of, say, complication in welding technology. Shivali, am I right? Hello? Is Shivali there?
Yes, sir. Due to heavy rain, sir, network problem is there, sir. There is very heavy rain and light is gone off. Sir, signal is...
It is. Your voice is clear right now. Have you heard my questions?
No, sir. Please repeat it.
My question was, how many of you have come across the term open circuit voltage, operating voltage and arc voltage?
Yes, sir.
Sir, listen it, but now yet not remembered.
So the open circuit voltage is when there is no arc and you measure a voltage across the two terminals of the power source. That is the open circuit voltage. And when the welding starts and you are depositing a bead, what voltage you read on the voltmeter of a machine is not the arc voltage, but it is the operating voltage. Operating voltage is the sum of all the voltage drops in the circuit, that is voltage drop in the cable, drop in the torch, drop in the, say, workpiece, drop in the return cable, drop in the transformer itself. So when you add up all these voltage drops, it comes to the operating voltage, that is what is read on the machine voltmeter. But in this relationship, it is the arc voltage which is required. And arc voltage is, I still have the slide on. No, here only I'll show you that. Arc voltage is from this tip of the electrode. Can you see my cursor?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
From this point to the surface of the workpiece, whatever voltage is existing here, that is the arc voltage. So when you have to use this heat input relationship, I have seen such kind of numericals given by the teachers and students attempting teachers checking, and students end up getting 10 out of 10. But the issue is, if I ask you, how do you get the value of arc voltage?
Sir, it is a potential difference between two terminals, sir.
How do you measure this? Two terminals, nahi. It is the potential difference between the tip of the electrode
and the workpiece.
Workpiece. So that gives you arc voltage.
Yes, sir.
How do you measure this?
This can be measured from, sir, current carrying
what?
Current carrying capacity of the electrode.
See, this is what I say. It is very easy to obtain a degree. I also got probably a degree like this only, but I've learned these terms when I come into a profession life. When I had to guide the research, I had to learn.
Okay, sir.
So when I came out of my, say, B.Tech college, I also came out with a paper degree.
Yes, sir.
So doesn't matter. You have to be a glove also. I hope that everybody has learned this thing, gone through the story of Eklavya and Dronacharya.
Yes, sir. Yes. He gave his thumb to the Dronacharya, sir.
He was a very shrewd teacher, not an honest person. He made him lose his thumb such that he cannot do archery.
He learned the thing by himself.
Such a cunning person. Do not fit into a category of a teacher or a guru.
Yes, 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 yes.
But from paper engineer to the qualified engineer, you will have to now become a glove, because time, whatever time is gone, is gone. So if take this as a home assignment, and anybody who feels interested in really knowing this can feel calling me on this number given here. But this is a very interesting problem which I have given to you, that how to calculate or get the value of arc voltage. Remember, if there is no arc and you measure voltage between two terminals of the power source, it is referred to as open circuit voltage. And the voltage which you measure during the welding operation is the operating voltage, and the voltage existing at the tip of the electrode to the workpiece is the arc voltage. And in this relationship, we use arc voltage, not the operating voltage or open circuit voltage. Please note it somewhere very carefully. Can you read this diagram yourself? Or in case of difficulty, just ask me, I will explain. But that probably will save time. This is a diagram which is showing you that two characteristics, one is the constant current, other is the constant voltage. And on this, the three lines are shown referring to the arc length. And this explains the feature or characteristic feature of constant current power source and constant voltage power source. In constant current power source, arc length remains constant, and thereby keeping the welding current constant, and the melting rate will be constant because it is directly proportional to the square of the welding current. But in constant voltage power source, there is a huge variation of welding current with a slight variation in arc voltage. So that brings a characteristic feature of this power source, which is referred to as
grouping characteristics.
What is the characteristic known as? This is known as self adjustment of welding arc. In constant voltage power source, it is used for, do you know the processes where we use constant current and constant voltage? Okay, I leave it to you. Note it down somewhere and fill in the blanks. This is just an idea of temperature existing in the welding arc. This is arc temperature distribution in GMA welding of aluminium at 250 amperes. And see what is the temperature you have achieved at 250 amperes of aluminium welding. It is just for academic interest. I am changing the slide. So metal transfer, the common modes of metal transfer are short circuit, globular, axial spray, and pulsed spray transfer. Just read this diagram. This is very important. This is having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 color bands, and there is a line which is shown as secondary transition line, first transition current, second transition current, then you have spray streaming rotating, and between two transition ranges you have a globular type of metal transfer or repelled transfer. And below the first transition current, you have a globular drip transfer. And this red color shows the range in where you get a short circuiting motor metal transfer. So when you are doing 3D printing, you have to decide scientifically and judiciously that what kind of metal transfer behavior you're going to select to get the desired shape finish of your 3D printed component. Okay. So this chart shows you that where you get a spray transfer, you will always get above the second transition current, and that is cannot be a strict line. That is why the two dotted lines are shown to show a narrow band in which the transition can occur, because it also depends upon the alloy content and so many other things. So this shows that spray transfer is possible only when your current is above the second transition line, streaming is beyond that, rotating is further. And if you want to do welding in globular mode, free drop or the repelled you have to choose according to this orange color. And then if you are trying to do welding using a short circuiting method, then your current range has to be within this, as shown or decided by the red color. So please read this. This is very important. Again, from whatever I'm discussing with you is not only welding, but everything is centering around the 3D printing. The density is defined as the current density level above which spray transfer occurs. In spray transfer mode, the electrode metal is transferred as tiny droplets across a stiff, stable arc. And current density is defined as the welding current divided by the area of cross-section of the welding filler wire. Hope this is clear.
Yes, sir.
So cross section of the welding filler wire. So suppose your wire diameter is 2 millimeters. What will be the area cross section? Sir, all right. I hope you all know how to calculate the area of cross section, and that divides the welding current to give you a current density. So it is very simple to understand. The higher the current density, higher the current density means a lower welding current. Also, you can get a transition current level for getting a spray transfer. Just read this. Suppose you have a 1.2 millimeter diameter and 0.8 millimeter diameter GMA welding filler wire, both operating at 150 ampere weld current. Calculate the current density for both the current levels. So when you are using 1.2 diameter wire, the current density is 74.6 ampere per millimeter square. When you reduce diameter to 0.8 millimeter, then your current density is 298.4. So now imagine that in aluminum MIG welding, you get a second transition level around 170-175 amperes. So even at 150 amperes using 1.2 millimeter wire, you will not be able to get a spray transfer. You will have to increase the current, thereby bigger power source, more radiation hazard, etc., etc. But if you reduce the wire diameter, you are getting a current density of 298.4 amperes per millimeter square, means for the same power source, you will be able to get a spray transfer very easily. And since the current level is low, your radiation hazard, etc., can all be reduced. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Which wire produces the deepest penetration? Greater the current density, the deeper the penetration. As a result, the smaller diameter wire will penetrate deeper than a large diameter wire at the same current, assuming all other factors like travel speed, etc., are constant. So in 3D printing, your objective is not to penetrate deep. Your objective is to deposit a layer on the surface, and this falls in the category of surfacing or cladding operations through welding, where if you look at this bead profiles shown here, they are going very deep. But in surfacing operation, they are kept very shallow. That is, the dilution level is kept to around 10 to 15%, not more than that. But in this condition, this may be around 60, 70%. So for surfacing operations, you have to select a current density which gives you a controlled dilution between somewhere around 10 to 15%, such that your crown height will be decided accordingly. So if you need a higher crown, you can use a bigger diameter. If you need a smaller crown, you can use a smaller diameter wire and select a welding power source accordingly. Clear? Any doubt?
No, sir.
So if the amperage flowing through the wire becomes too great, the welding arc becomes unstable and erratic. So at that point, it is time to increase the welding wire diameter. This will lower the current density and stabilize the arc. Please try and understand the intricacy what is explained here. Conversely, if the amperage is too low for a wire diameter, the arc will want to pop, stick, or produce excessive sputter. At this point, a smaller wire diameter may fix the problem. So, are you clear of that? What is the direct current, what is reverse polarity, and what is straight polarity?
Yes, sir.
But these days, we seldom use reverse polarity or straight polarity just because it always gives you a confusion. After a few months, you will start scratching your head. The reverse means what, positive or negative? This will always create an element of doubt. So to overcome this, it is used straight away as direct current electrode positive or direct current electrode negative, DCEP or DCEN. So when you use these two terms, there will never be a confusion. Clear? It's very easy to understand now.
Yes, sir.
So the mode of metal transfer is determined by many mitigating factors: base metal type, filler metal composition, electrode diameter, polarity, arc current, arc voltage, arc length, shielding gas composition, welding position. Different transfer behavior referred to as droplet transfer mode can be observed influenced by that a growth time dimension and detachment frequency. So please read. the last point is very important from the 3D printing point of view. The controlled material transfer modes have been a significant development in the last decade due to enhanced power source control features using the welding parameters to generate unique type of droplet transfer. And this unique types of droplet transfer are very much required for deciding the quality of the surface finish, that speed, type, and everything is decided by this kind of special power sources. So you can quickly go through the type of metal transfer. I think I'll skip this and go to the this explains this better. Short circuit transfer, globe droplet start developing, and then it start growing in size because of continuous melting of electrode here and touches the molten pool which is existing. So short circuiting is taking place, and because there will be sudden rush of current like you have in electrical short circuits, so that causes the very high pinch effect or necking taking place. The detachment takes place and the arc goes off and then again ignited. But this sudden rush of welding current due to short circuiting taking place creates a phenomena which is referred to as weld sputter. How many of you are aware of the term weld sputter? Please do not think that I'm taking your exam or anything. It is just to, for my understanding, that how much I have to go deep. Anybody who needs a reason for weld sputter or sputter taking place? Sputtering is the flying of small droplets away from the arc zone, which we call as splinters or sparks or something coming out of the arc zone during welding. So ideally we do not need any sparks flying out or any molten metal flying away from the weld pool, because you have paid for the filler wire, and any amount of filler wire not becoming the part of weld pool is a loss to the owner or the welding operator, because that much amount of filler wire is not contributing the weld metal. Globular transfer, you see, very interesting thing is the size of the globule is bigger than the diameter of the wire here. While in the spray mode, the diameter of the droplet is less than the diameter of this wire. The streaming spray, things in that diagram are shown that streaming, you go only after you cross this spray. So the as you are moving from spray to the streaming transfer or the mist transfer, the size of the droplet will keep on decreasing, and since the amount of metal which is melting is same or higher, so what will happen? The droplet size decreases, but the frequency of transfer increases. This, I think, is understandable. From the same volume of metal, if you are detaching small size droplets, you will be detaching more number of droplets compared to the bigger droplet, right? So distinguishing feature between global transfer or the spray transfer, where you have the transition line, is the size of the droplet which is developing, if it is greater than the diameter of the wire, we call this as a globular transfer. Here the detachment will be predominantly by the force of gravity and not by the electromagnetic force. And the moment you enter the spray transfer range, the electromotive force takes over or overrides all other forces and creates necking, and that necking forces the droplet away from the wire. Better view of metal transfer as discussed in the previous slide. Same principle, this is a bigger globule than the diameter of the wire. This is globular transfer. This is projected or the spray transfer. This is streaming or spread mist transfer. Further increase in current density will cause further reduction in droplet size and convert the metal coming out in the form of mist. It's like, you know, when you press the top of a perfume bottle, you see a very fine mist coming out. So that is the level to which the droplets are decreases. And beyond that, you enter into a mode which is not generally used. That is the rotating transfer. Rotating transfer means like the what happens to the molten metal here. It starts oscillating, and it means you have no control on the place where the molten metal will get deposited. So it can be used for filling up the wide weld grooves, but not otherwise. And this uses a very heavy current, causing an increase in heat affected zone, which you again dislike. Can I change?
Okay, sir.
So this is what is described here is electromagnetic force directly proportional to the square of the welding current, and higher the electromagnetic force or the pinch effect or pinch force or the Lorentz force, this creates a necking, and necking means you are excusing the molten metal, and the fast excusing means droplet detachment will take place. This you can skip. Very quick, you can read the various forces which act on a droplet. The predominant force or the three forces which assist in the droplet detachment or traveling to a workpiece, they are the electromagnetic force, electromotive force, then gravity force, and the drag force. That is the shielding gas which is flowing also tries to detach the droplet from the tip and transports it to the weld pool. And the two forces which oppose the detachment of the droplet are the surface tension force and the vapor pressure. This I think I've already explained. Can I skip?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. This is of particular interest these days, related in terms of the 3D printing. And reason is you are basically guiding detachment of droplet at your will. So please read this very quickly. Done.
Yes, sir.
The same thing shown here. Global developing, getting elongated because of the gravity and the forces acting on it. Necking taking place, and it is bridging the gap between electrode and the weld pool, causing the sudden rush of current, and that sudden rush of current is causing sputter as shown in the diagram, and the separation takes place, and arc is getting will reestablish, globule will form again, the same process will continue. So this is how you can read a short circuit transfer on the oscilloscope. Can I change?
Yes, sir.
Pulse current transfer is a spread type transfer that occurs in pulses at regularly spaced intervals rather than at random intervals. In the time interval between pulses, the welding current is reduced and no metal transfer occurs. The pulsing action is obtained by combining the outputs of two power supplies working at two current levels. One acts as a background current to preheat and precondition the advancing continuously fed electrode. The other power supply furnishes a peak current for forcing the drop from the electrode to the joint being welded. The peaking current is a half-wave direct current because it is tied into line frequency. Just see this. Blue is showing the pulse, that is the output of the power source is in this shape. So this red line shows the peak current, and this blue line at the bottom shows the background current, and this is a time interval for which the background current remains on, and this is the time interval for which the pulse remains on. So you have the two times here, pulsing time, pulse time, and the background current time, then peak current and the background current level. So in this, we may strike arc initially as a background current level. It starts hitting the electrode, start developing the globule at the tip. Then the current rises, and when the droplet is of the desired size as we have calculated before, the pulse injection, that is a peak current pulse is injected into the circuit, that is from red line to this line, and this causes this necking to take place. And this necking takes place means you are ensuring that one droplet is getting detached per cycle. That is, in per cycle you are detaching one droplet. So depending on the number of cycles you have, you can say that you have transferred so many drops during welding. So depending upon the parameter you select, you can decide the size of the droplet and the frequency of transfer within a parametric window. It is not an unlimited range, but you will have to develop a parametric window in such a way that you are able to detach a droplet per pulse. So this is giving some idea about the developments in low heat input transfer modes. Low heat input transfer modes are important because they do not overheat or bring the metal in the fluid state, such that the flowability of the molten metal is kept in control and you get a better geometric and a geometric finish. Well, a dimension control and finish. This mode determines the operating features of the process. Historically, it is considered that there are three principal metal transfer modes: short circuiting or dip, droplet or spray, and pulsed. This you can leave. Just read this, equipment development. Please help me, quick reading is required. Change.
Yes, sir.
Because I have to show you two small videos related to the metal transfer. I think I'll first show you the. Read this. These are the trade names which various manufacturers have adopted or given to their equipment for this kind of metal transfer taking place for 3D printing. So do not get confused when you read this kind of trade names. You go by the basic fundamental, what kind of metal transfer they are giving you. This is all showing that what kind of pulses or waveform they are using for controlling the detachment of a wave droplet at the desired point or the desired size. Let me, I think, see the electric control. The advantage given here is the wire is fed down as the arrow is showing here. Can you see the arrow?
Yes, sir.
You have the arc and wire is fed down. And wire is continuously feeding down. Droplets is developing here. And then what happens is, when the short circuiting takes place, there will be a sudden rush of welding current. And that will create a lot of disturbance in the weld pool. Lot of sputter will be there, and you will get a poor surface finish. So what a particular company has done here is, this is done by Fronius, that the wire feeding is reversed. The moment sensor feels that is going to create a short circuit, at that moment it immediately reverses, pulls back the wire. So because of short circuit, the force of surface tension pulls the drop into the weld pool, but the wire goes up, thereby giving a very smooth metal transfer without any sputter. And this is how the metal is deposited for 3D printing. So this I'll show you with the help of video. Would you like to see the video?
So no, sir. No, it's lunchtime now, sir.
Okay, sir. Show it, sir.
Shivali, इतनी फास्टिंग रखती है, उसके बाद तो मैं 5 मिनट में क्या हो जाएगा बताओ।
चलो ठीक है, ओके ओके सर, नो प्रॉब्लम सर।
मैं आपका एहसान मंद रहूंगा शिवाली।
ओ नहीं नहीं सर, ऐसे मत बोलिए प्लीज।
Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
No, sir, not that much clear, sir. The video sound is not clear that much.
Video is not clear?
No, sir, audio is not
clear. Audio is not clear.
Sir, audio is not clear.
Okay, give me 1 minute. I will add speakers to my system. It will take 1 minute, but you will be very comfortable with the audio.
Okay, sir.
Okay, okay.
Sir. Give me 1 minute. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Sir, आपकी आवाज आ रही है, वीडियो के नहीं आ रही?
मेरी आवाज आ रही है?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Transfer. Both are further enhanced by waveform control technology. Waveform control technology controls every aspect of the output waveform.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
It's okay, sir.
Oh, yes, you want me to increase the volume?
Okay, sir.
First, a high-speed control delivers the ideal instantaneous welding output. Each weld is made up of individual droplets of weld metal. The high-speed control regulates the development and transfer of each droplet. The second control, the slower-speed control, adapts the wave shape to maintain the proper arc length. Let's look at the characteristics of the 5 major metal transfer processes in greater detail, starting with short-circuiting transfer. Short arc has the lowest heat input, making it a very fast follow process. The weld puddle freezes quickly to allow efficient out-of-position welding. Equipment for this process is relatively inexpensive, but the short circuit process produces some spatter, has low deposition rates, and lack of fusion is not uncommon. Here is a close-up of the short circuiting process. There's some spatter. a little bit of violence associated with the arc. The crisp buzzing sound is caused by periodic short circuits. By using high-speed photography, you can actually see droplets forming on the end of the electrode. Current is applied, the droplet pinched off, and transferred into the puddle. Spatter occurs when the shorting is not done perfectly or there is interference to the puddle. Spatter balls can pop out of the very violent puddle as it oscillates. Globular transfer uses higher energy levels than short arc and higher wire feed speeds. This process offers a very fast follow or high speed characteristics, high deposition rates, and very good penetration. However, when viewed up close, globular transfer exhibits extreme violence in the arc. The violence of the process is shown by the large droplet size. The arc is not forming anywhere on the droplet. A current density, I to pinch off the droplet, cannot be reached. Gravity and uncontrolled electrical magnetic fields dominate this transfer method. A droplet often wheels around in space as it is pushed by the arc from one point to another. You will see violent explosions as the arc actually shorts out. The current rises high to try to pinch the droplet off, but fusion occurs and the very large droplet is thrown out of the weld zone. This violence in the process accounts for the excessive spatter. The operating range of the globular transfer method is very wide. When we increase the energy levels above globular and short arc, spray arc occurs. The spray arc transfer mode offers a very stable arc and is typically spatter free. This is normally used on heavier plate. Advantages include high deposition, fast fill, and very deep penetration. Many metals can be welded by spray arc, including steel, alloys, aluminum, and copper. However, highly inert gases such as argon and helium must dominate shielding gas mixtures. High heat input is required for the spray transfer. Because the weld puddle is large and fluid, the process can only be used for flat or horizontal welding. Due to higher heat inputs, spray arcs can cause undercutting. The spray arc process has a very controlled, stable arc. There's little spatter, minimal shorting. Molten metal streams from the electrode end. The magnetic field from the arc surrounds the wire. The high magnetic force from that field pinches the wire down at the end. Molten droplets stream through the arc to the workpiece. Surface tension transfer, or STT, is a proprietary Lincoln Electric process. Spatter levels are very low, even when welding with CO2 in the short-circuiting mode. Heat input is optimized. STT, a fast follow process, permits high travel speeds and precise control of the bead size and shape. It is particularly efficient for automated welding of thin gauge steel. This process provides good penetration. The weld puddle is tightly controllable because of the low heat input and controlled weld metal transfer. Difficult applications like nickel alloys and open root welding are easily accomplished with the smooth arc. This waveform schematic depicts very rapid changes in current. The STT machine responds to changes in and the condition of the welding arc. Current is raised and lowered to transfer molten droplets cleanly. Normally, violent short arc or globular transfer processes are stabilized. Here's STT welding with CO2 shielding gas. There's very low spatter. The arc is well controlled. If this were a normal short-circuiting process, there would be higher spatter levels. With the STT process, droplet size is tightly controlled. Transfer to the workpiece is clean. Compare this to the large droplets of globular transfer. When an abnormality occurs, the high-speed current control of the STT power source adapts to transfer droplets smoothly. Let's break down the waveform for a better understanding of waveform control technology. The STT provides a very specific waveform control that instantaneously reacts to the arc during short arc welding. At the initial shorting of the electrode, the STT process reduces the current or energy to minimize spatter. Next, a high current is applied, accelerating the molten metal transfer to the weld puddle. Prior to fuse separation, the current is reduced in millionths of a second to reduce the explosive nature of the molten metal transfer. A plasma boost current is then imposed on the arc. It melts the electrode back. This reduces spatter and fume generation. The arc current is then reduced to the background level in a controlled manner, reducing weld puddle agitation. It is the instantaneous control over the current that eliminates the highly violent and explosive energy of short arc MIG welding. Now, what if we applied waveform control logic to more than just short arc MIG? We would have a precise control of the arc through a very broad wire feed speed range. That is the major benefit of using the Lincoln PowerWave pulsed arc welding process. The process allows wire feed speeds ranging from 50 to 1200 inches per minute, and it's virtually spatter free across the entire range. With precise control of arc dynamics, the power wave can be used as a fast follow process at high travel speeds, or it can be run as a high deposition rate fast fill process. Precise control of the output waveform varies the arc characteristics. Weld out of position easily with the gas metal arc power wave process. The arc is very stable. The power wave is very effective for welding steel, stainless, aluminum, and most alloys. The pulsed spray arc is as stable as a converted spray arc. The pulsing process transfers small droplets directly through the arc. One droplet during each pulse. As the wire is advanced, the current pulses and transfers the next droplet. Let's look at the pulse process at a higher wire feed speed. This is not pure pulse welding, rather an intermittent spray arc welding. The PowerWave power source has waveform control technology. It provides a very fast front edge in the pulse, transferring the droplets quickly. The back edge of the pulse falls at a controlled rate to add the heat input needed to wet the droplet into the puddle. Pulse spray is stable at a wide range of wire feed speeds. The process offers more advantages at both higher and lower wire feed speeds than converted axial spray. But with the waveform control technology processes, there is much more processing versatility and capability. More choices are available when adjusting the arc length of these processes. Controlling the welding process depends on how we change the instantaneous parameters together to achieve the most stable arc. The magic of the power wave is that we have pre-programmed a computer to help you set welding procedures. We took a PowerWave synergic power source and loaded it with 045 L56 wire and used a 90-10 argon CO2 blend. We started at 100 inches per minute wire feed speed and increased the procedure to 650 inches per minute. The synergic property of the power wave sets the correct arc length for each wire feed speed. The CV mode is first. Note the definite transition between the short circuiting, the globular, and spray arc transfer ranges. The differences between the three transfer modes are significant. At the high end of the spray arc range, the arc begins to rotate and eventually becomes unstable. Now, let's run the power wave in the pulsed mode through the same 100 to 650 inches per minute wire feed speed range. The spray arc transfer mode is maintained across the entire range. No spatter occurs at any point along the range. At the high end, the arc remains stable and does not rotate. Pulse generates a controlled heat input to control distortion and burn through and to aid in out-of-position welding. The occasional visible spatter from the pulse process does not stick to the workpiece or torch. The small droplets do not contain enough energy to fuse to the workpiece. The power wave welding procedures provide enough heat input to make a sound weld while minimizing spatter by controlling the weld puddle.
shift the limits. No empty promise this, but hard fact. Shifting limits and making the impossible possible. This is what CMT is all about. Cold metal transfer, a revolutionary cold joining technology. For the first time ever, the wire motions have been integrated into the overall process. This keeps the average heat input very low, which is good news for the metal, of course. Another really great feature of CMT, spanter-free welding and brazing seams. CMT is suitable for all materials, even for ultralight gauge sheets from 0.3 millimeters and for MIG brazing. At high process speeds, shifting the limits then. Fronius has done pioneering work on joining steel to aluminium, for example. This used not to be possible. Now it is. The steel side is brazed and the aluminium side is welded. Crash tests have proved that these joints are absolutely safe and reliable, even when subjected to the most extreme stressing. Now that's shifting the limits for you.
हेलो
हेलो हाँ सर यू आर ऑडिबल
अब मैं आपसे विदा चाहूंगा आपने मुझे इतना समय दिया आई होप कि कुछ जस्टिस हुआ है आपके प्रोग्राम के अंदर और भविष्य में याद करें तो अच्छा लगेगा
बिल्कुल सर श्योर बहुत 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 धन्यवाद सर आपको जो
Any question from the audience?
No questions, sir.
Sir, finally, which mode of transfer you are going to suggest for micro manufacturing, which is it is a additive manufacturing?
See, right? Now you are coming to the real practical side of this lecture. The CMT as shown to you, which is a company calls a cold metal transfer. So do not mistake by touching the welded specimen. You will have the tough time. Cold means it is little colder than the conventional arc welding heat. So we generally in that mode, they are using a short circuiting mode, but they are successful in doing so because they retract the wire immediately. In the conventional arc welding system, the wire feeds continuously in one direction only. But in CMT machine, the moment it touches the weld pool, the wire starts traveling in the reverse direction. So by which it breaks the short-circuiting rush of current, no aspect takes place and it is only the clean deposit of matter. But all those people who still want to do 3D printing, for them, the conventional short circuit transfer will not result in a acceptable situation. So you have to develop a parametric window using the spray mode of metal transfer such that the pattern is not there and you can control the size of the droplet and the frequency of transfer. And for this reason, you will probably be requiring one dual beam oscilloscope connected to the power welding system and record both the waveforms for voltage and current, and that will help you in analyzing the frequency of transfer and the quality of weld which you are getting. So one simple project to your BTech or MTech students could be developing a parametric window for a spray transfer.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Sir, do you have any idea of the cost of any of the CMT, Fronius made manual CMT?
In between the lecture, I'll tell you again. If you buy only the power source, that will cost you anywhere from 12 lakh to 15 lakhs. And if you are trying to buy the robotic arm they are supplying in a combination with the power source, your bill will go beyond 30 lakhs. So I want advise you, that is a production machine. You think of it at the later stage, but first do your metal printing using conventional power source. These companies will never encourage you for doing so, because for them it is a business. And for you, nation building is your objective. Career building of the young engineers is your objective. So try and convert the existing power sources into the machines which are more suitable for the 3D printing. That can be your project. You can start converting the conventional machines to the machine suitable for 3D printing. You can have a roaring business. You will not look back. You will have bags full of money and money only. So think of using your wisdom. Think of using your potential, mental potential, in developing or modifying the technology, such that you are benefited, your family is benefited, society is benefited, your institute is benefited, country is benefited, industry is benefited, and they remember you as there was some qualified welding engineer who gave us this. So with this, I'd like to wish you a very, very bright future. I hope that God gives you enough courage and enthusiasm to achieve your objectives and targets. And I would be very happy to see you prospering. Keep progressing, keep prospering. All the very best. May God bless you all. Thank you, Professor Arun Pandey.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
You permit me to log off now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Shivali, khana kha lo aap.
Okay, sir. Thank you, ji. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, bye.
Bye, sir. Bye. There AI information for all participants. Next lecture, basically, that will start from the 2:40 in place of the 2:30. It will delay by the 10 minutes, so it will start 2:40. Please, you may take your lunch, and after taking lunch, please join at the 2:40. The next lecture, basically, that is also very interesting. The speaker is from the industry, basically, that is the RR Belt Center, Raja Ramanna Laser Centers from the Indore. So he will also give us some practical exposure related to the micro manufacturing or micro machining based on the different types of the lasers. So thank you very much for all participants. Please take your lunch and please join in time at the 2:40 or before the 2:40. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.